Hi, I'm Benoit, the creator of Arduino JSON. In this video, I'll introduce the Arduino JSON assistant. I'm assuming you already know the basics of the library. The Arduino JSON assistant is an online tool that helps you write the code for the Arduino JSON library. As you know, this library employs fixed memory allocation to provide the best performance with the smallest code. Unfortunately, this forces the programmer to choose the right buffer capacity upfront. And that's where the Arduino assistant helps. But we'll see that the assistant does much more than measure the document capacity. You'll find the Arduino JSON assistant on arduinojson.org. Click on the Assistant tab at the top. Notice that there are two versions of the assistant. One for Arduino JSON 6 and an older version for Arduino JSON 5. You can switch between them by clicking on the version selector on the navigation bar. As you see, version 5 is significantly different. In this video, I'll only talk about version 6. The assistant was designed as a wizard containing four steps. In most cases, you will set the settings for the current step before moving to the next, but you can also jump directly to a step by clicking on its number. Step 1 defines the general configuration for your project. First, you must select the microcontroller in the processor field. Then, you must choose the mode. Deserialize means using Arduino JSON to decode a JSON document. That's the most common scenario. Serialize means that you use Arduino JSON to generate a JSON document. I'll keep deserialize and filter for a future video. The last field depends on the selected mode. When deserialize is selected, this field specifies the type of input that you pass to deserialize JSON. When serialize is selected, it specifies the type of output that you pass to serialize JSON. You'll notice that the assistant shows a little comment depending on the selected value. For example, if you select string, it will say, "This is most likely a bad choice. Prefer SHA-STAR or stream." In most cases, you'll use stream because the JSON document often comes from a file or a TCP connection. Finally, the assistant reminds you that it was designed for a specific library version, so you should verify that you are using the same one on your program. You'll see a different message if your ad blocker blocks arduinojson.org. Instead, you'll see your ad blocker is blocking web analytics. Please consider whitelisting arduinojson.org. Indeed, the Arduino JSON assistant reports some key analytics like the selected processor, mode, and memory usage. For example, I can see that in the last months, almost 70% of users have an ESP8266 or an ESP32. This information helps me understand how people use the library and make better design decisions, so please unblock arduinojson.org. Let's move to the next step. In the second step, you must enter the JSON document that your program should deserialize. That's because we chose the deserialize mode in step 1. If we had selected the serialize mode, it would say output here. At the bottom right of the input box, there is a prettify button that fixes the indentation of your JSON document. This doesn't affect the result of the assistant, but makes the document easier to read. Above the input, there are two links to predefined examples. If you click on either link, it downloads the sample and replaces the input document. These two examples are used in the case studies of my book, Mastering Arduino JSON. This page also gives you some warning about your document. For example, if your document is deeply nested, the assistant warns you that you'll have to pass an extra argument to deserialize JSON. If your document contains a very large integer, the assistant recommends enabling long support. If your document contains a floating point value with many decimal places, the assistant will tell you that you'll not be able to reach this level of accuracy on an AVR since this architecture only supports 32-bit floats. Finally, if your document contains a string that contains a JSON document, the assistant will tell you that your document suffers from the JSON in JSON syndrome, and that you'll have to call deserialize JSON more than once. Before moving on to the next step, let's revert the input to its initial state. The third step shows how much memory is required to deserialize the given JSON document. The first row shows the number of bytes consumed by Arduino JSON's data structures. On the AVR architecture, it takes 8 bytes for each node of the document. A node can be either a value, an array, or an object, and the root node is not counted. In our case, there are 5 nodes if we exclude the root, which consumes 40 bytes. Clicking on the information sign at the end of the row will show the expression used to compute this result. Indeed, our document is an object containing 3 members, and one of them is an array of 2 elements. The second row shows the number of bytes consumed by the strings. A string of n characters takes n plus 1 bytes in memory. In our case, the sum is 21. Clicking on the information sign at the end of the row reminds you of the settings for string storage. We'll get back to that in a moment. The third row is the sum of the 2 previous rows. Adding the size of the data structures with the size of the string gives us the total memory used by the document. You could use this value in your program and it will work. However, any change in the input could make the JSON document overflow. For example, if the sensor value changes from GPS 3 characters to Galileo 7 characters, the memory requirements rises from 61 to 64 bytes. To mitigate this problem, the Arduino JSON assistant includes a false row that shows the recommended capacity for the JSON document. To compute this value, it adds 10% to the side occupied by strings and rounds the total to the next round binary value. Adding a 10% slack for the strings gives your program some room for the things that are most likely to change. Rounding to a binary value avoids the padding after a static JSON document or the lost heap space after a dynamic JSON document. Most users should use this recommended value, but the assistant allows you to customize how this value is computed. If you expand the Tweaks section, you will reveal these advanced settings. The settings present in this section depend on the configuration from step 1. For example, I chose the AVR architecture, so the assistant lets me customize the integral storage, which can be either long or long-long, but doesn't let me change the floating point storage, which could be either float or double, but these types are identical on AVR. Also, since we are currently in the deserialize mode, The assistant doesn't show the serialization specific option that allows us to say that strings shouldn't be stored in the JSON document. These two checkboxes are very similar, except that the first concerns string values and the second concerns keys. They both control whether string deduplication is accounted for or not. Indeed, the Arduino JSON library deduplicates strings. When a JSON document contains the same string multiple times, it only stores one copy of the characters. This feature is excellent because it allows the JSON document to be smaller, but it could make the assistant result artificially low, and that's why the first option is disabled by default. For example, suppose our document contains a list of identifiers. Let's say that the project specification says that each identifier is 5 characters long, and that we can have up to 4 of them. If we go back to step 3 and toggle the deduplicate values checkbox, the result doesn't change. That's because all the IDs are different. Let's see what happens if we use a single placeholder instead of unique identifiers. Now, when we check deduplicate values, we can see that the recommended capacity drops from 96 to 74 bytes. The problem is that 64 will only work if the four strings are identical, and your program will fail to deserialize a JSON input that contains four different strings. That's why this box is unchecked by default. However, if you know that your input contains duplicate strings that are not placeholders, for example, the weather conditions like rain, sunny, or windy in a weather forecast, you should check this box because it will give you a result closer to the actual memory usage. You might be wondering why deduplication is disabled by default for values and enabled for keys. From my experience, people often use placeholder for values, especially for username or passwords, but rarely use placeholder for keys. Indeed, the JSON specification doesn't allow you to use the same key multiple times, so you cannot use a generic placeholder. Repeated keys appear in a different object and are generally part of the schema of the JSON document. To be clear, these two checkboxes only change the computation done by the assistant. They do not affect the library. Arduino JSON will try to deduplicate all strings. As you saw, when the current settings differ from the defaults, the assistant shows a small orange button with the number of differences. Clicking on this button resets all the settings to their default values. There are still a few hidden gems in this step. First, if the input is too big for the selected architecture, the assistant shows a red sign with the message, "This is too big to fit in the RAM," and a link to the documentation. Similarly, if the input is not so big but still requires some care, the assistant shows an orange sign with the message, "This may not fit in the RAM." Lastly, if you get this message on ESP32, it will also show a link to the page that tells you how to use the external RAM. Let me restore our original JSON input before moving on. The fourth and last step of the Arduino JSON assistant contains the skeleton of a program that deserializes the given input using Arduino JSON. This program depends on the option selected on step 1. For example, if we select an architecture that supports flash strings, it will use the F macro. If we select x86 or x64, the assistant assumes that serial.print is not available and uses stdcr to print the error. if we change the input type, the program will adapt the call to deserialize JSON. If the document is too big to be stored in the stack, the program switches from static JSON document to dynamic JSON document. The actual threshold depends on the selected architecture. For example, it's 1 kilobyte on ESP8266 and 2 kilobytes on ESP32. If the document contains a repetitive block, like an array of objects with the same members, the assistant rewrites the program with a loop. If you change the library configuration, a warning will appear at the top of step 4 to remind you to redefine the required macros. If we change the mode to serialize, the program will be completely different. The program will adapt to the syntax of the document. Here, we can see it's calling create nested object because it has several values, but if the object only contains one value, the assistant will chain multiple subscript operators to simplify the program. If the input is deeply nested, the program will pass the required argument to deserialize JSON. Finally, you will find links to the relevant documentation pages at the bottom of the program.
And that's mostly what there is to know about the Arduino JSON Assistant. Of course, I intentionally skipped the part about filtering, but apart from that, I think I covered everything. I hope this video helps you understand how the Arduino JSON Assistant works. I recently made it open source, so don't hesitate to have a look at the inside. You'll find the link to the repository in the video description. Please reserve the comment section below for the question and remarks about this video. If you discover a bug or you want a new feature on the Arduino JSON Assistant, please open an issue on GitHub. Don't forget to like this video to encourage me to produce more content like this. Bye!